do it with me, man. Good morning. All right. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you for showing up this morning. Now that we've released some of the youth, if you have some space next to you, it was a little bit crowded, but I think it's all beginning to make sense. Amen. Welcome to Journey Church. My name is Leonard Small. You, on behalf of Pastor Vic, inside of your church bulletin, there's this little white slip of paper. If this is your first time visiting us, can you please fill that out for us? And also, if you have any prayer requests as well. Today we're going to go ahead and get ready to receive our offering. We'll go ahead and call the ushers forward. Today we're going to be praying for the body of Christ. How many churches there in Jacksonville? There's one church. And what is the church? Family of God. Living on mission. Amen. All right, so let us go ahead and pray for this offering. Dear Lord, we just thank you for your grace and your mercy. We thank you, Lord God, for giving us another day. It is a gift. And Lord, we thank you for the fellowship of your saints. We thank you for the word that's getting ready. And may it encourage us, Lord God, and propel us into what you've called us to do. We thank you for all these and many other blessings we pray for. I'm sorry, Lord God. We pray for all our brothers and sisters in faith all around Jacksonville. Those who are struggling in their faith, Lord God, we thank you for the ones who you sent to us today. May we serve them in a way that will bring glory to you. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen? Amen. That is a light thing when you come visit us, so we thank you for coming. If you look inside of your church bulletin, the first thing you'll see is the Guatemala missions trip that is coming up very quick on us. So if you still would like, the sign-up is still in the cafe when you first walk in. Make sure you sign up there. Little plug for Night Missions. If you're unable to attend, information on what you can do to help them, they have some needs. It says they're ordering bug spray, peanut butter. Let me just speak about that real quick. Night Missions is when a group of people here at Journey, they just go out and just serve. There's no pretense. There's no gimmick. They just go out and find people in the street, and they just love on them. So if you can't meet any of those needs on there for Night Missions crew, just pray for them, because they're what we call in the military the pointy end of the stick. All right, so pray for them. Also, there's a partnership class coming up here soon on October 12th, and one of the biggest portions of this bulletin is the children's ministry. It is a great opportunity to be a discipler of the little baby Christians. So, if you have any children back there, if you feel called to teach in children's ministry, please sign up.
All right. Good to see all of you this morning. You guys awake? Alive? If I look tired, that's because I am. Stayed up and watched Florida. I watched Kentucky give the game to Florida last night. Gators won. See, you guys aren't that excited about that, right? Because it was. Anyhow, life is about much more than football. Amen. It's baseball. There's basketball. No, I'm kidding. If you're visiting with us this morning, I want to welcome you to Journey Church, the gathering of the church. As Leonard pointed out, there's one church in our city throughout the world, and that church gathers in different places, and so we're gathered here today as one part of that body. And the church, we like to say, is the family of God living on, and it's not just something we do on Sunday mornings. Really, we become a part of the church when we encounter the living Christ, the one who died, sang about and talked about earlier, who rose from the dead, who sent his spirit to live inside those of us who would put our faith in him. And when that happens, when we put our faith in Christ, our life from the inside out. You can't encounter Jesus, you can't encounter God without something changing inside of you. And at that point, the scripture talks about we are then adopted as family, the church, the body of Christ. And it's a beautiful thing. And last week, if you were here, we saw some of the fruit of that up close and personal as those boys from Guatemala sharing with us. And if you weren't here, I'd encourage you, go and watch that video. Just to hear the hearts of these boys who come from a very poor rural village in Guatemala. Opportunity to come to the States and experience what we experience and what we take for granted. And to hear them share their hearts was just an awesome thing. And so they left here and went to New York City. There's a picture, I think a picture of them that should come up here in Times Square. How awesome is that, huh? I love the guys with the shades on. Cool. But there they are in Times Square. Just, I mean, for them, listen, this is a miracle. An absolute miracle. They haven't even left their country before. On an airplane up close and personal. And then to come to the States and experience this. And the one thing I would say about that is after sharing with some of them, hearing them share and then talking with some of them, experiencing the love of Jesus in a very, very personal way. I mean, you heard some of their stories, boys who don't have fathers, fathers who beat them, fathers who drink away the little bit of money that they have and provide for their family. And then in come these gringos, you know, for no reason whatsoever, gathering them together, loving them, sharing the love of God, and then giving them like this. And it's not that they feel love because they're given stuff or given this opportunity. They just know that they're loved because they are welcomed into a family. And that's what Brock and them have done, is they've welcomed them into their family. And the church is, it's not an institution, it's a family. And we see that throughout Scripture. And so we've been going through this series that we're calling Church. And this morning I'm going to do kind of a part two on a message we did earlier, the body of Christ. So I'm going to go through some scriptures again, but you know how the Bible's really cool, how you can read one of it, something will jump out at you, and then you'll find yourself in that same area reading again, and another word or another little phrase in that same passage will have different meaning to you. And so tonight I want to angle on some scriptures, that a few of them that we've already looked at, but we are going to talk about the fact that the church is a body, not a building. It's a family. It's not an institution. We are the church, and we need one another to be all that God desires for the church to be. So we're going to begin in 1 Corinthians 12, but before we do, I want to pray as we get going. I pray this morning that you would bring revelation to our hearts, God, of who you are, who we are in light of our relationship with you, and God, what your word says that we are called. And I pray that we would leave this place changed in some way. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, 1 Corinthians 12, beginning in verse 12. The body is a unit. This is Paul speaking about the church. And he goes, the body is a unit, though it is made up of many parts. And he uses the body as an analogy of the church. And though all the parts are many, they form one body. So it is with Christ. For we are baptized by one Spirit into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, slave or free, and we were all given one Spirit to drink. So there is this diverse group of people. Back then, he goes, Jews, Gentiles, look around the room. A diverse group of people called to be together, unified by the Spirit of Jesus. So the family of God is a diverse group. And if you look around, just in this room, we see that diversity. But again, the church goes beyond these walls, right? So it's not just us who are gathered here. It's the Baptists down the road. It's the Methodists, the Lutherans. Yeah, even some of those Catholics, all right? I mean, so the body is very diverse, and the Spirit of Jesus unifies us. And it says we can be one body made up of many parts. Verse 14, now the body is not made up but of many. And if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God changed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one. One body, many parts, all necessary for the body to function properly, to function the way that God intended. Now look at verse 18. who is it that arranged the parts of the body? God. Okay? So God arranges the parts of the body just as He wanted them to be. God has a plan. And God creates people. The Scripture says everything was made by Him and for Him. So we are created by Him and for Him. So He has a plan. And He creates us. He gives us gifts. And He calls us to be a part of this body called the church. And whether you're an arm or an eye, or I don't know. He's gifted you to be a part of that. He's arranged the parts. And we need to be able to say, okay, God, I'm good with that. I'm good with how You created me and what You've made me in and what You've called me to be. You can't be something that God didn't create you to be. And so we have to stop thinking like, oh, we talked about it a couple weeks ago, that the guy up here is the guy who's really gifted, or the person who goes on missions, they're the ones who God's really using. I can't be Reed Fitzgerald. I'm just not that funny. God didn't gift me that way. I don't have that quirkiness, you know. I teach, you know. Every once in a while you laugh. I'm hoping it's not at me, but with me. But God didn't call me to be someone else. He didn't create me to be someone else. He didn't create you to be someone else. Be all that God created you to be. Be empowered by God, and then do what He's called you to do. One body, many parts. He arranged it. He has a plan. And He wants us to join Him in His plan. God knows what He's doing. Do you? Okay, that's the question. Do we know? We need to trust Him. We need to join Him in what He's doing. Verse 21, the eye cannot say, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with and the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has combined the members of the body and has given great parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but that the parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is part of it. See, the body is a single unit made of many parts. All parts are necessary. And God arranges it. And in God's system, every part is important. It's amazing to think that even the parts of the body seem as unnecessary, have little importance. God says, no, they're very important. In God's kingdom, the armpit is a blessing to the people. Every part, I'm not calling you an armpit, okay? I'm just saying, okay, every part is needed. And so to be content with that and desire to grow in the gifting, the calling that God has for you. And really, it's a daily surrender to Him. God, You made me. You've given me a new day, like we sang about. It's Your breath. I want to live for You. And I want to do whatever You called me to do and gifted me to do. I want to turn away from the world. I want to turn toward You. Fill me with Your Spirit. Use me. Empower me to do what You've called me to do. Together as a family, then the body of Christ becomes a beautiful, beautiful thing. Verse 26, if one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part's honored, rejoices. Now you're the body of Christ. Each one of you is a part of it, and each one of you is important. It's hard for those verses to be real if you define church by Sunday morning. Right? I mean, because we can't all be active in what God's called us to do on Sunday morning. There's plenty to do in helping here, but that's not what the church is. It's the family of God living together on mission. And so this morning, I want to invite one member of the family up this morning. Stephen, you come on up. This is Stephen Jones. He's going to come up and just share a little. Oh, you're both coming up. You surprised me. Come on, Stephen and Erica. Erica says, I'm not talking, but I'll stand up here. And Stephen had just contacted me and said, hey, we'd just like to share a little bit of something, how God blessed us as a family. And so let's just share what happened. with your daughter, Audrey, and I tried to get a picture up, but it didn't work.
No problem.
Sorry.
Like Vic said, I'm Steven, this is Erica, and we've been coming to Journey for about 6 months now. And I've just really been loving it. And here about a month ago, our daughter spilled some coffee on her hands and got second-degree burns on both of her hands. And we were in the hospital. And we reached out to Vic and Reed and some other people here at the church real quickly, and just people we had met coming into the doors and going in houses, and we just felt love. We felt love so quickly, so easily. And the strange thing was, as we kind of talked to each other, we said, you know what? We haven't been to class. We haven't volunteered in a bunch of stuff. We haven't gone up the ranks like it is in other churches of, hey, you know what? If I go up this rank, oh, people are going to call me, and I got Vic to call me. Awesome. We didn't do any of that. And we just felt so much love just from prayers that people were giving us, thoughts, bringing a meal of food. And it was just amazing. It was truly amazing to feel God working through Journey on our lives. We didn't want to come up here and talk about us at all. It was just talking about is using this community of believers to affect us. And it really just, it changed our hearts. We just felt God's love in a greater way than we've ever had through a church.
Awesome. Awesome. Thanks for sharing.
Thank you.
And Stephen, it's a good thing that you didn't try to go up the ranks. Because there are no ranks, and that rung would be missing. You'd be like, "What?" But listen, this it's such an important story for you to hear, because it's the body of Christ coming together. It wasn't like, I did something to the staff. It was just the people of God doing what God's called them to do. And you might be sitting there going, "Man, I've been struggling. No one's reached out to me." Well, you do have to engage in some degree in those relationships. You know, the church is large gatherings like this, but they met from house to house. So when those opportunities come about, you need to avail yourself to those opportunities. I'm starting a small group Bible study, 7 o'clock on Tuesday mornings. It's just one opportunity for guys to come out and meet some other guys, grow. Vinny's doing one on Monday evenings. That's an opportunity. The ladies just had a retreat. There's different opportunities. You do have to step into those circles a little bit. Or just hang out a little bit out here. Don't run out so fast. Just stay afterwards. Hang out. Meet some people. See how important you are in the body. Because you hear about somebody who has a need, or you hear about someone who goes through a hard time, and a simple phone call or a text, "Hey, we're praying for you. Can we bring you?" What it does is it shows the love of God to people. See, that's what the church does. It's an extension of who He is. 1 Peter 7:10 says, "The end of all things is near. Therefore be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love is a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in his forms." Okay, so this is Peter. This isn't the crazy guy on the side of the road with the 6-foot cross, going, "The end is near." But Peter's reminding us, listen, the end is near. One day, everything that we know will cease to exist. That is truth. That's a reality. And if that end of all things doesn't happen before then, each of us is going to be put in a box in the ground, or our ashes sprinkled somewhere. It's going to come to an end. So he goes, "Hey, be aware of that. Be sober-minded. Understand the reality of life so that you can pray. And then love one another, because a multitude of sins. Forgive, love, extend hospitality. Love each other deeply." And then look at verse 10. "One should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms." Okay. Everyone's been a gift from God, at least one. You're gifted in some area. He created you. He has gifted you. You come into a relationship with him. You become a part of the body. changes the parts of the body because He has a plan. There's things He wants to accomplish. And when we surrender to that and we follow Him, then we become a part of that plan. And in that plan, God wants to show this love to the world that desperately needs to know it. So we receive grace and love through Jesus. His death on the cross allows us to have that relationship with the Father. We can be adopted into the family because of what He's done. So when that happens to us, we have something to offer the world. Quite honestly, I think the core of why we're here. Because God wants us to know His love deeply, and then He wants us to share that with people around us. So, we all have been given these gifts, but in verse 10 He says, use whatever gift you've received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in various forms. Grace, unmerited, undeserved favor. Okay? God extends His grace to us in Jesus. We are forgiven, accepted because of what Christ has done. He has given us His grace. He has shown us His love. God also shows us His grace, now get this, through one another. You've been given a gift, and it says you administer God's grace in His various forms. You and I have the ability to show people tangibly the love of God. That's incredible. I mean, think about that. The Greek word administer means steward. So God's given us gifts. We're to steward those gifts. And we're stewards of His grace and His love. So there's people who live around us. There's people in our neighborhoods. There's people in your workplace. There's people all around us who need to know the love of God. There's people who are blessed. There's people who are in just desperate situations who need to know the love of God. And God has given us gifts and given us the ability to administrate, to steward, to love and grace to people. So God expresses His love to people through me. It's real. It's tangible. He does that through you. Every part of the body has a role to play in this. It doesn't matter if you're a teacher or, quote, what we call a missionary. We all have a part to play. God shows His goodness, love, and grace to people through you and through me. So as God empowers us by His Spirit, we just have to be sensitive to what's going on around us. Be awake in the moment. Know the people who are in need. People maybe in this very room, people sitting next to you, people who have gone through difficult times, people who need to know the love of God. Think about it. What's the greatest need that we have? Okay, if you think about just as human beings, what are our greatest needs? Beyond the physical, food, air, water, what we need to survive, what's the greatest need of a person? I think it's the need to be loved. To know that we're loved. To know that we're loved deeply. Okay? I think it's the greatest need. You go, when we think about money, wealth, how many people you know or have known who've had all of that and been miserable? People who've taken their own lives. So that's not the answer, right? We need to know that we're loved. And there's people who need to know that they're loved here in Jacksonville as much as Guatemala, here in this room as much as Haiti. People outdoors who wouldn't step into this room. But here's the crazy, cool thing, right? Greatest need of every human being, to be loved, to know that they're loved. Every human being, every person in this room has the ability to meet that need. Have you ever thought about that? The greatest need that we have, the greatest need that I have, is to love. To know that God loves me and there's people who love me. And you have the ability to meet that need for somebody. And you go, well, man, I mean, you don't know my background. It's dysfunctional. Listen, you have the ability to show love. And if you know Jesus, the Spirit of God fills you and you're empowered to do it in a way that's beyond what you can even imagine. That body, and somehow you administer God's grace. Like, God wants to show that person love, but you know what? He needs someone who's willing to raise their hand and go, okay, I'm here, I'll do it. Surrender to it. And it's not the special, what we see is the special parts of the body. It's everybody. to introduce you to another part of the body here at Journey. I'm going to ask Carl and Lisa Norton to come up. Carl and Lisa, come on up. Some of you know them. Some of you might remember a few weeks back, we actually, during the service, when we baptized the one Norton baby, and we prayed for them because Lisa lost her father. No, we baptized one coming in, and we prayed for you when your father had passed away not long ago. There's a lot going on in your lives. Tell us a little bit about you, how long you've been in Jacksonville, have ages, things like that.
Okay. We've been in Jacksonville for 3 years, and we have 6 children. Lacey, the girl, is 16. We just took to Liberty University. Aaliyah's 14. Noah's 11. Molly's 8. Kaylee's 5. And Arabella will be 2 next week.
I'm not even going to try to keep that straight, right? I got 3 and I have a hard time. So you've been at Journey for 3 years. And what initially brought you to Jacksonville, and what have you guys been doing while you're here in Jacksonville? Okay.
We were in Mexico doing children's ministry, and we felt God redirecting our lives, and so we got invited to serve at the International Learning Center here in Jacksonville, and it's a center where people come from all over the world to learn English from the country, and so we were working with them for the last 3 years, and we were doing their just kind of learning about the center and just helping out however we could, but also doing the Spanish ministry. So when people who came in really spoke Spanish, we could, you know, communicate with them and help them through the process of getting into their classes and just other needs that they had, just, you know, so they would have someone that could speak the same language as they.
And the International Learning Center is a really cool ministry. It's not far from here, probably less than a mile and a half from here. We support that ministry. They reach out to a lot of the refugees who come into Jacksonville. 20 to 30 refugee families every month that come into our city, and they share the love of Jesus with them in just a really, really cool way. And so they were a part of that ministry. There's others here who volunteer that ministry. And so you guys came initially saying, we're going to be here for 3 years. Mm-hmm. And so that 3 years is up. And yeah. So now what has God been doing, and what are your plans here in the next season?
Well, about a year and a half ago, Vic mentioned this project that might be starting in Guatemala of tomato greenhouses to help out families and to help the mom provide for their families. And it's like at that point, just God put it on my heart, well, what about those kids? And so from there, the Project for Hope starting and to take care of these mothers with no husbands at home and to provide for their kids, to give them a life where they can be a parent instead of gone from early in the morning and getting back late at night and the kids fending for themselves. So we're going to go help the seeds with the and kind of oversee all the children, make sure they're getting fed, educated, health taken care of, and so just loving on these kids as best we can.
Many of you haven't really heard much about that ministry. We haven't talked about it lately, but because we're in the process of actually getting land and a building, which we can kind of relate to, right? But about that there in Guatemala and Project for Hope. We have a video. We're going to show this video. It's real brief, but it'll give you an introduction to the ministry there. You met who live in an area there. This is a ministry to a different group of people in need in Guatemala. So watch this video. I guess we can just hang here and we'll
Our family's been on the ground here in Magdalena for 3 years working with the 1212 Love Project. Love Project is a housing ministry. We're working with families that are living in terrible housing conditions. And in our time here, we've encountered these fatherless families that are literally struggling for survival. And we begin to ask ourselves the question, how can we impact these families that don't have a father, they're widows, or they're single moms? Maybe dad died. Maybe dad just left and left totally on their own. And we begin to ask that question, how can we impact these fatherless families? How can we help them exit from this cycle of poverty where mom never received an education? Now she's by herself with four kids. She can't even help kids with homework. She's not employable. And life is a battle for survival. So what we envision at Project for Hope is empowering these ladies to earn a fair wage, to be home with their kids in the afternoon after a work day, that the kids can get the education, and together they can begin the healing process. We read in the Bible that widows, the marginalized, are close to the heart of God. That resonated with us. Project for Hope was born out of our experience with 1212, working with these mothers, getting to know them, and just having this desire, okay, God's doing something here. We need to participate and begin to take steps towards the ministry come to fruition that can meet physical needs, but also nourish the family spiritually.
For those of you who don't know, the Steeds were part of the family here at Journey for a number of years, and about felt like the Lord leading them to go to Guatemala and to serve there. They've been serving with the 1212 Love Project, and as you heard Chris share, now they're going to continue with this ministry Project for Hope. There's just a great need there. If you've ever been, there's a lot of people in there who have been on those trips. Some of those single moms will work in the city, and they'll have an hour to an hour and a half each way where they'll go in to work. Enough money to put food on the table, not even healthy food, and they'll leave a 10-year-old or an 8-year-old with a 5-year-old and a 2-year-old home. Just leave them and go. It's a little different than the US, all right? And so this is an opportunity. They're going to do these tomato greenhouses. They'll work right there in their village and on site, that the kids will be cared for. They're going to serve in that role, right? Working with the kids and... what's your timetable here? When do you see yourselves going?
Well, right now, we're closing on our house the end of this month. So we just talked to Chris last night, and then, like, the end of October, kind of we can transition down there. So it's coming quickly.
So when you guys go, the ministry is not up and running. What are you going to do for the first few months and everything?
We need to touch up on Spanish. So for 2-3 months, we're going to... intensive Spanish. But also during that, all these 1212 families, a lot of these are the ones that are going to work at the greenhouses, so just start getting to know those families. Really important. It's like there are so many families that are down there. They've done 140 houses.
Yeah.
And so many families. And to start getting to know these families and the ones that we're going to be working with, and just transitioning as far as that goes.
Yeah. That's ministry there, showing them the love of God just through living with them and being with them and meeting needs however we can. Now, as you guys get ready to go, how can we connect with you? I mean, as a body, as a church, we're going to come alongside and support you. But do you guys have like a list where people can sign up, get a newsletter, or what are some ways that we can support?
Yeah, we send out a monthly newsletter. And so we can, if you want to give us your email address, we can add you onto that list. So we can put a sign up. We can get a... And so that's how we can connect. Right now, we're part of our mission covering or whatever is Commission to Every Nation, which is out of Kerrville, Texas. So that's kind of our mission organization. So most of our finances go through Commission to Every Nation. So in there, it's online. So, you know, giving can be online or through the church or however, you know, you want. But that is an option, too.
Okay. Awesome. Well, let me pray for you guys before you go. And they're not leaving quite yet, so we'll let you know before they leave. But if you want to connect with them, talk to them, and be praying for them, or give if you're interested in giving directly to what they're doing. We pray for you guys. God, thank you for Lisa and Carl. Thank you for just their willingness to just be the part. called them to be and to go where you've called them to go and to take their children. We pray that you'd bless them. We pray that you'd meet every need that they have, God, and that you'd go before them and just the transition would be as smooth as possible. We thank you that we can come alongside them, and we look forward to seeing all you're going to do through their ministry there in Guatemala. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks, guys. All right. So, isn't it awesome to just see what God's doing? I mean, it's a fairly small group of people here that has grown over the years, and the Steeds being there in Guatemala now, and now the Nortons going there, and it's just really cool to see all that God's doing through this body. But here's the temptation that we have to be careful of. The temptation is to think, Carl and Lisa, they're the ones who are really going and doing the ministry, right? They're the ones who are really going with God. But listen, they're being the part of the body that God's called them to be, surrendering to that. Not everyone's called to do that. Praise God, right? I mean, I'm happy that God's called me to be here. But listen, if he said, go, would you? I loved it when Brock, I don't know if you guys caught it last week, here sharing. Brock and Carrie Johnson live in Guatemala with their children, and they were sharing with the boys, and he said, yeah, me and Paul, we said, we don't like to refer to ourselves as missionaries, because that gives the impression that we're something special. We've just gone and are doing what God's called us to do, all of us as Christians, but we're doing it in Guatemala. And so Jesus said, go, disciples of all nations. That applies to all of us. Listen, I'm sorry, but you can't opt out of that one. All right? So I don't know how you do it in your context or where you do it. It starts with surrendering to Him, using the gifts that He's given you to show the love of God to the people around you. 2 Corinthians 5, 14-21. For Christ's love tells us, because we're convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And He died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for Him who died and was raised again. So He died for us and were forgiven and adopted into God's family. He died for us that we might receive life, but He also died that we might do something. Okay? I mean, I hate to be the guy who has to tell you this, but this is the Bible. And He died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for Him who died for them and was raised again. It's hard to be a selfish follower of Jesus. Now, we all do it at times. But I'm just here to tell you, He died so that you might receive life, but He also died so that the people around you might receive life. Do it through you. And that can happen as you give, it can happen as you go, it can happen as you pray, it can happen as you are blessing, just giving a meal to someone. It happens in so many ways. He gives, administers it in various forms as we use our gifts for Him. And there's people all around us who need to know the love of God. Picture from last Sunday, if you were here, of Johnny. And this is minor. Now look at the faces of the boys in the background. This is a little, and Minor was interviewing him. I just love this little guy. He just grabs my heart. He's 15, I think he was. He's like that big. Minor was interviewing him. He shared about some of the struggles in his family. You know, he shared that his brother and his brother got married. Him and his wife live in the household, and and he's got another brother, and it was the same thing. And but I know a little bit more of Johnny's story. You know, in the last year, one of the things he didn't share was in the last year, the other guys, Grandpa, I remember Grandpa, that guy shared about his dad beating them and alcoholism and all that. Johnny's dad is the same way. But within the last year, he came home one day and found his dad hanging in the house. And so what does he do? Who does he call? Johnson's broken-hearted little guy. And he calls them. Why? Because he knows they care for him, that they love him. That's a place where he's found love. I mean, that's Guatemala, but that's all around us, okay? It's all around us. People who need to know the love of God, people who, we're all some people who just never had that poured into them at a young age. Some of us who have a hard time believing that we could be used by God. We have a hard time believing that God created us and that He loves us for who we are. Some of us have a hard time standing in front of the mirror in the morning and looking and saying, you're good. And you've created something good. And I want to live for you today. There's people all around us like that. There's people probably in this room like that. The gospel is God loves you. And He demonstrated His love for you in this, that while you were still a sinner, back turned toward God, Jesus died for you. That's how much He loves you. He created you and He's called you and He wants to use you to share that love with other people. Maurice, if you guys will come back up, the band. And He wants to use all of us to share that love. And it's pretty simple. It's really a matter of faith. It's a matter of believing that. It's a matter of surrendering to that. Don't try to be someone else. God created you, and you know what? Maybe what some people have said is true. When He created you, He broke the mold. All right? There's only one reason. Because there's unique things on this earth that God wants to do through you. We have to surrender to Him. God, you. And first, I've got to receive His love. First, I have to know. I have to know that I'm loved. So I need you. You need me. And as much as we go and do the things of God out there, listen, we need help here. As a member of the body, engage here. You know, the rooms get, and you come in and I'm sorry about that. We're praying. We're hoping that this, you know, we get this permit. We can move forward in the building soon. But until then, it's a little tight. Our kids' area, it's a little crowded back. Extend grace to one another. If you have a child being served in the back, by all means, please serve back there. Now you might go, hey, that's not the God's gift to me. Well, listen, that's one area. It doesn't matter if you're gifted or not. I'm just going to tell you, if you have a kid back there, God's called you to be back there. All right? My kids, listen, Victor and say, Victor, I need you to go and I need you to go cut the grass. He doesn't go, Dad, I'm really, God hasn't gifted me to do that. Okay. God's gifted you with a house that you stay in, and I happen to own it. All right? So be thankful. You know, that's what I would tell them, right? So listen, God's blessed us. He's blessed us with so much. We need. I just need to share this before we wrap up. You know, Shantae and Julie and Lori are back there. They help administrate the stuff with our kids, and they do a fantastic job. But for us to know, they're not paid to be back in those classrooms and take care of our kids. They're paid to administrate that, to prepare it, so that all of us can go and make disciples of our children so that we can extend God's love and grace to them. So, my wife is 7 years now, Journey's been going, and at least once a month, and in the early days, three times a month, four times a month, we've been back, or not me. She's been back there helping. It's just something we do as a part of the family. So even if you haven't gone through partnership and that kind of, please help. And one last thing on this. If you see, you know, Ante or Lori in here in the service, leave them alone, okay? Because they're not working at that point, okay? At least twice a month they need to be in here. And unfortunately, they've been back there for months at a time and haven't had a relief. Now listen, that's not the body functioning the way the body should function. It's not healthy. We all do our part. And we know it's not all about Sunday morning, but what a blessing to gather, to worship together through music, to hear the Word of God, and then to respond. So we need each other. Context. We need each other. We walk out in this messy world and experience everything it throws at us. We need each other. We need to be a body, a family. If you would stand. sing this last song, but as we do and we prepare our hearts, I want to pray for us, and I just feel the need to pray and just do something. So if you would just close your eyes. And we're going to sing about this love that has come down in Jesus. And I just sense that there's some people who, you know, for us to go out and share that love with people, we need to know it deeply. See, that scripture said, love one another. I can't love someone deeply unless I know that I'm deeply loved. Listen, hear the voice of God. The scripture tells us that you are loved. It says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I created you. You're fearfully, wonderfully made, just how I desired. And I love you. And I sent my son to die for you. If you don't believe that you're loved, just look at that. Jesus beaten, spit on, hung on a cross for nothing that he did. For our sins, for our God goes, I love you that much. Look at the cross. I love you that much. Believe it. Receive it. Holy Spirit, speak to our hearts. Fill us. Even as we sing this song, some of us go and share communion. God, just remind us of your love for us and how you showed that to us. For us to show it to one another.
Of all that you've done.
God, help us to believe that. God, that we're yours, that nothing can snatch us out of your kingdom. Death, demons, angels, nothing can take us out of your hand, God. Just help us, Lord, to not walk away. Help us, God, not to turn our back. Help us to turn toward you and receive the love that's just waiting. God, thank you for loving us. Thank you that you would take people like us in this room, everyday people, and use us to show your love and grace to this world that desperately needs it. God, help us to receive first, to be full and overflowing, that we have something to give to the people around us. May you get all the glory for that, God. I want to be used by you. And in that we find life and purpose and significance. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have any needs, there'll be some of us up here. We'd love to pray with you about what's going on in life. God bless you as you go. Go in the power and the grace of God and give that grace around you this week. God bless you. Peace be with you. See you soon.